Okay, now for something completely different. Just so you know, I've only once actually spoken this outside of my head. So be kind to me. Okay, my life, I actually have some little crib notes here. It's not a tattoo. In case I get distracted. The first part of my life was I was plagued with self-doubt until I came up with this idea. It's not really deep, but it's an idea. And it helped me put more of my energy into my career, into my personal relationships, and less into my insecurities. So the idea I have lovingly called life loops. It could be life circles, but I like loops because I've based it on this. Our property, we have this old farmhouse, my husband and I, and we have this this path that loops around, and we walk it almost every day. And on this loop, we would come up with sort of dreams and schemes of how we wanted our life to be. You know, we would argue, we would be in love, whatever happens on those walks with your significant other. And on this walk, our life started to happen. First, we had a little puppy that would go on the walk. Then we had a baby. And then we had two kids that would tag along. And now we have two young adults and another dog. And we walked this loop, and our house would change, our life changed, our career changed, and we kind of created this beautiful life. So I'm calling this life loops. All right, so I thought to give you an idea, I have to really give you some personal anecdotes. I'm going to use my life as an example to describe this loop theory. I don't know, theory is a bit of a stretch, but anyway. Okay, so I'm going to give you this. You can have all kinds of loops in your life. You can have hundreds, you can have four, depends on you, depends on your life. So I'm going to start with a small loop in my life, okay? So a small loop would be, when I was a child, I was in love with Mr. Dressup, in a platonic way. And I would watch it, religiously, and what I loved, in case you're not familiar with him, Ernie Coombs was the star of Mr. Dressup, it's a national program, yeah, please, I know, he was my hero. And the show ran from sort of the 60s to the 80s, maybe early 90s. But the thing I loved the most about Ernie Coombs and Mr. Dressup was that he would draw when he talked. I don't know if you remember, he would draw a story. And it seemed like magic, because if you don't know how to draw, and you're watching something come unfold, it's magical. And the same with music. You know, if you don't know how to play an instrument, you hear a beautiful piece of music. So anyway, So Mr. Dressup. So I was in love with him. I was inspired by him and ultimately became an artist because of him. Because in my rural little town, we didn't have any art to inspire me. So my dream was to... Oh, I should show you kind of what Mr. Dressup does here. So he would have like a piece of paper. I have silk canvas. Let's see. So since we're talking about loops, I'm going to do a little loop for you. Dripping all over the stage. There. Not too exciting, but we'll see. So then I want to meet him, and a few years later, after I have this career, I find he's coming to Halifax, and he's doing his goodbye tour. And so I take my very young son as an excuse to go watch Mr. Dressup, basically, and I sat in the front row, and I sobbed through the whole thing, because I just couldn't believe how lucky I was to be sitting there watching him in real life and have my son with me, and I was very moved. And anyway, a few years after that, not long after, he actually passed away. When he passed away, I was actually working on an exhibit, ironically called Endings and Beginnings. And so I thought, I'm going to paint him into my exhibit. So I did a painting of myself holding Mr. Dressup like a baby, and I was sobbing, and I was sitting on the tickle trunk. Now, you must know the tickle trunk is a prop in Mr. Dressup's. It's not something I'm just making up for the fun of it. So here was a lovely little loop. I started my life being inspired by this man, actually created a career because of him, went to watch him real life with my own child, and then when he passed away, I created a piece of artwork that was inspired by him once again. That's a little loop, just a nice little loop in my life. So now I'm going to give you an example of a bigger loop. So I'm going to use my career, okay? So let's start here so I don't get carried away. Okay. Let's see how far we can go. So I'm going to start my loop here. So I started as a painter. And we're going to skip a whole bunch because I've had a big life. So we're starting me as a painter. It's really exciting. I started a big, and I thought, well, okay, I started to do trade shows. I was painting on silk. I started, you know, where the cocktail party, to the cocktail party. I was doing that. I started doing these big backdrops. People started buying the backdrops, and then galleries came. I started having gallery shows. That would be a lovely loop. I had a career, went to art college. I became a painter. I did this wearable stuff, and now I've got gallery shows. But it wasn't enough. I wanted the loop to be bigger and bigger. So I start thinking three-dimensionally. I think, what could I build? So I start thinking, well, I could build a little installation. So I had this idea for an installation, and I built it. And a theater company saw it and said, would you like to design some theater for us, for children? So I thought, fantastic. I didn't know what I was going to I was terrified, but I thought, yes, I'm going to do it because it's scary. So if you're scared of something, you should do it. Because even if you fail miserably, at least you're going to learn never to do that again, number one. And if you don't learn that, then you'll grow from the experience, right? You're going to, and somehow something will happen. It always does. In my life experience, that has worked for me. So I designed the show, ended up designing a few shows and worked for them. And then I thought, well, I can build my own because, you know, I know how to do this now. So I started building my own installations. While I was doing that, I was visiting schools and talking to kids about art, and I would draw these pictures, sort of like this, and I would start telling a story. And I would say, you know, whatever, they wanted me to, I would just make it up as I went along. And I thought, boy, wouldn't this be fun to do for adults? I bet you adults would enjoy this, because I'd enjoy Mr. Dress-Up, and I still, even as an adult, I would sit and watch that. So I came up with this idea to do these performance pieces where I would paint and draw in public. And I got some musician friends, and then we started touring, and it became a whole other aspect of my career. And these giant ones, love them, much bigger than this. And so now I'm built, so Stuart McLean sees me. One night he's hosting a show I was doing. He comes up, Stuart McLean, because you don't know of him. He's a storyteller on CBC. He has Stuart McLean, the Vinyl Café. And he tours the country with musicians, and he's very popular. And I admired him. He's a great storyteller. So he came up to me and said, holy cow, would you like to go on tour with me? And why not? You know, I was absolutely terrified. This could be a big fail. I had no idea what it entailed. It actually meant 1 month, 26 shows across the country. And 16 feet every single show, painting to his stories and music. So it was big. So anyhow, so I went and did, but that's not even the exciting part. Here's the exciting part. So I get to the show, and they try me out because what if the band hates me? And so I'm standing there, and I'm painting. And after, his tour manager comes up to me and says, Holly, do you know who you remind me of? I said, no. Who? He goes, Ernie Coombs. Do you know who Ernie Coombs is? And I said, Mr. Dress-Up? Oh, my, I love Mr. Dress-Up. And I went on about how he inspired me, and that's why I'm doing this. And I, you know, was almost in tears. And he looks at me and goes, Mr. Dress-Up was my best friend. And then he says, in fact, he lived with me for part of his life with our family. And then he regaled me with these amazing stories of Mr. Dress-Up. And I'm talking from a man who loved Mr. Dress-Up. So that's the best way to hear a story, right? And then he took us to his home, the whole crew, everybody. And we had dinner in his home. And there on the wall, it may as well have been the Mona Lisa. It was original Ernie Coombs paintings on the wall. I mean, I almost fell to my knees. It was so beautiful. So here I am experiencing this. And all of a sudden, these little loops, right, they start to grow. They just grow, right? And they also start to converge. So that all of a sudden, this big giant loop of my career is converging. I'm going to give you a little bit more, there we go, with this. And I started looking at all the loops in my life. And I got to continue on. So that was even the most exciting part. So I told them while I was there, I really want to paint with a symphony. That was my dream. And it's easier said than done. So anyway, we had performed three shows at the National Art Centre. And somebody saw me there. 2 weeks later, I got home. They called me up and said, do you want to come perform with our symphony? Right, opening the loop, keep opening the loop, got bigger and bigger and wonderful. So I said, terrific. So I was going to go perform the symphony. It takes a year for these things to happen. The day before it happened, this was a snowstorm. I cannot get out of Halifax. I cannot get to my dream to paint with the symphony. So my sisters, I get on the phone, I'm going, oh my God, whatever, crying. My sisters all get on, I have these amazing sisters. They all start, one starts calling up using all her points, one starts trying to get me on the train, my mother's in Ottawa waiting for me, and they're all like going crazy. One sister finally she had a guy who had a Hummer. And so she gets in, she has her pajamas on, she jumps in the car, we're driving to Ottawa in a snowstorm. And we did, we drove to Ottawa. And I got there at 10 o'clock, ready for rehearsal. I did two shows back-to-back with no sleep. And then we jumped in the Hummer, slept behind a pizza shop for a couple hours, and drove home. And the reason I drove home, right, was because Stuart McLean and the Vinyl Café coincidentally were coming to my house for dinner, and it was my son's 12th birthday, and there was no way I was going to miss it. So they pull in, I come out, and I say, Stuart, you won't believe what just happened. I got to finally perform the symphony, but we drove in a Hummer, and all this other crazy stuff happened I can't get into because I'm running out of time. And he says, Holly, that's a Vinyl Café story. And so all of a sudden, I've met loops within loops of life. And next thing I know, I am now a Vinyl Café story. Stuart McLean. So, you know, the more I opened up to every possibility, and the more I just relaxed, everything would just start happening. These wonderful things would keep happening. And my family, you know, my family was this little, you know, we had a little tight loop because we were having a little bit of problems at the time. And all that love, they just poured onto me. That loop just stretched wide and opened up for communication and understanding. You know? And I start thinking about that in my relationships and how we have all these little loops all over our lives to start, you know. We might have a friend and then something falls apart and we close off the loop and we just push it aside because it's too painful to deal with. We have even things way more serious than that. So it becomes like this little Cheerio floating around, you know. It's all crispy, you can't stretch it or anything. But what I realize that if you just sort of relax, take a deep breath, and you kind of go at things with open eyes and excitement and the possibility of opportunity, and you kind of open up your heart and think generous, think kind, and I'm telling you, things will just happen. It just loops open up. And those relationships that happened way back when maybe I wasn't ready to deal with that, and I'm older and more mature now, and then one day I might bump into the parking lot, instead of pretending I don't see them, I'll walk up to them and say, hey, do you remember that time? Wasn't that stupid? And things can change. And it's amazing. It's amazing. And I think the older I am, the more I've seen it happen over and over again. And so what I'm going to ask you to do, if you think of your own lives and start looking at the loops you have in your life and wonder why maybe this career loop's really big, like my big career loop here, but your family loop is really tight like a little Cheerio. And then wonder why is that? You know, and are you ready to maybe change that? And I'm telling you, if you go in with an open heart, it's amazing what can happen. This sounds really hokey, but I swear it works. I swear by personal experience, it absolutely works. And you can create a really beautiful life. And really, it's all choices. That's what it comes down to. It's just a choice of what kind of life do you want to live? Do you want to be bitter and twisted and tight and hard and not forgiving? Then you'll be the Cheerios floating around. But if you don't, you want to be soft and open and gracious and generous. It'll stretch, and they'll collide, and they'll converge like a bubbles. You know when bubbles, they hit, and then they slowly become one big bubble? It's sort of like that. And it works. So you know what? I know you're probably thinking I'm insane, but I swear it will work. And what I'm going to try and do now with this little mess I've got going here, in my couple minutes I have left, I'm going to work very fast, I'm going to try and turn it into something beautiful, something lovely, these little loops that I've started here in. Wish me luck. 2 minutes.
Thank you.